Thanks to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow list show. As a SciShow viewer, you can keep building your STEM skills with a 30-day free trial and 20% off an annual premium subscription at brilliant.org/scishow. If you're a coffee drinker, you've probably heard a lot of rules about how to brew the perfect cup. Like some people say that iced coffee is an abomination, or that you have to have the greatest Italian-made machine to make halfway decent Java. It gets kind of hard to separate coffee fact from myth. Luckily, there's a whole stack of research that can help. Brewing a beautiful cup of liquid gold may be an art form, but it's also very much a science. And we at SciShow are here to fill you in on all that rich, balanced, and sometimes nutty research and show you how to make perfect coffee. It all starts with the coffee bean, which is the first point to debunk. Coffee beans aren't beans at all. Sure, they might look bean-shaped, but beans are the seeds of legume plants, and coffee isn't a legume. So those little nuggets are just normal seeds. But since nearly every English-speaking person calls them coffee beans, that's what we'll stick with in this video. Okay, so if you're anything like me, you spend way too long staring at the shelves in the supermarket only to end up buying whatever's on sale. After all, nobody can actually taste a difference in those blends, right? Well, not so much. The two most widely used coffee plants, Arabica and Robusta, have measurably different amounts of the four main compounds that give coffee its signature flavors. First, you've got the alkaloids. Those are compounds that have at least one nitrogen group in them, and most have a ring structure. The two main alkaloids in coffee are caffeine and trigonelline, and both contribute to coffee's bitter taste. Some studies have found that unroasted Robusta beans have around twice the caffeine that Arabica beans do, but only around two-thirds of the trigonelline, which overall would make Robusta a more bitter bean. The second main group of compounds in coffee are acids, in particular quinic and caffeic acids, and chlorogenic acid, which is a combination of the two. And since it has acid in the name, you can bet that these compounds give coffee its astringent or sour taste. Robusta has around 1.5 to 2 times more chlorogenic acid than Arabica on average, so as well as being more bitter, it's a little more astringent too. Then there's sucrose, or sugar, which, unsurprisingly, gives coffee its sweet notes, but also breaks down during roasting to more sweet-tasting compounds. One reaction in particular, called the Maillard reaction, happens when amino acids and sugars combine and give coffee its brown color and taste. Raw Arabica beans have more sucrose than Robusta, which gives Arabica caramel, fruity, or fermented aromas when it breaks down. Last up are furans, which give roasted coffee most of its flavor and, in particular, those malty or sweet notes. They're formed when carbohydrates or unsaturated fatty acids break down during roasting, and there's more of them in roasted Arabica versus roasted Robusta, giving Arabica beans sweet almondy flavors. So picking the perfect bean for the flavor profile you want in your final cup is pretty vital, even though you might not be thinking about furans or acid while you're in the coffee aisle. Okay, but maybe you're less concerned about flavor notes and bouquets and more interested in getting the maximum amount of caffeine as quickly as possible. You've got a deadline. So as you frantically Google how to jam as much caffeine into your system as possible, you may have read that lighter roasts pack more of a caffeine punch than darker ones. I'm sorry to tell you that this is a bit of a myth, and here's why. See, a lighter roast of coffee literally just means it was roasted for less time or at lower temperatures. And while some compounds in those beans break down during roasting, caffeine isn't one of them. But even though caffeine doesn't break down, it can be released during roasting as the pores of the coffee beans close up, gas builds up inside, and the beans eventually crack open. However, different studies have assessed the level of caffeine depending on the roast level, and most have pretty much found no significant difference. But there can still be a bit of truth to this myth, depending on how you're measuring out your beans for that cup of joe. See, the beans lose mass as they roast, but they also grow in volume. That means darker roasts get lighter and take up more space than the lightly roasted ones. So if you're comparing light versus dark roast scoop for scoop, you're probably measuring out fewer beans and therefore potentially less caffeine. Despite all that, the differences between a dark and light roast are probably so small you wouldn't notice when drinking it. All right, you've picked your beans and ground them, and now it's time to brew. In scientific speak, many of the properties of coffee, like smell, flavor, and texture, come down to chemical and physical kinetics, how chemicals react and how things move. You might not immediately think of coffee as something that's moving, but brewing coffee is all about hot water moving over or around coffee grounds, either because it's forced with pressure or thanks to gravity. There are a couple ways this can happen. There are infusion methods, like pour over, where water flows over the coffee grounds and those grounds soak in water, usually hot, for a short time before being filtered, all with the help of gravity to pull the brew through. Infusion methods usually result in a milder, less harsh cup of coffee and are well suited to bringing out lighter, fruitier flavors. Decoction methods, like percolator coffee, boil the grounds in hot water before condensing the coffee vapors back into a liquid. Those high temperatures of a decoction method mean the coffee compounds are sucked out of the grounds really quickly, but there's also not a lot of contact time between the grounds and the water, so you end up losing some flavor and ending up with a very strong cup of pretty bitter coffee. Then you've got pressure methods, like espresso, where you force hot water over tightly compacted grounds. Yes, espresso is a method of making coffee, not a specific kind of bean. Although you may see bags on the store shelves labeled espresso, it's not actually espresso unless it's brewed into, well, espresso. The combination of slightly different particle sizes in espresso grounds means those grounds get packed together when you press down on them before popping them into the machine. And that makes the mix better at withstanding pressure during brewing. Then, if there's good resistance to the pressure, the energy from the hot water is transferred to the coffee ground block, extracting more oils with the water and giving the deep flavor and creamy texture of espresso. So picking out your method of coffee concocting matters a lot. If you really want to dial in particular coffee flavors, you might want to take a hard look at your water source too. Hard water is full of positive ions, like magnesium and calcium ions, that can grab onto flavorful compounds. Funny enough, those ions might just make your final brew that much better. See, each of those molecules that gives coffee its flavor, whether it's caffeine or one of the acids, have some negatively charged electrons around. The positively charged ions in hard water get attracted to these negative parts of the coffee compounds, which helps pull them into the water. In a 2014 study, researchers looked at how well magnesium, sodium, and calcium bind to the coffee compounds like caffeine, malic, citric, quinic, and chlorogenic acids, as well as a spicy clove-flavored compound called eugenol. They found that magnesium bound most strongly and closely to all the compounds, followed by calcium. Sodium didn't really cling onto any of the compounds any more than water molecules did. So according to this study at least, opt for magnesium-rich water if you want to get the maximum flavor out of your beans. But there's a catch. You also need to make sure that water has enough bicarbonate in it to keep the acidic components in check. So yeah, that one coffee shop bro boasting about how they triple osmosis filter their water might be doing more to make even less flavorful coffee. So now that you've picked out your bag of beans at the store, you may be staring at that giant coffee grinder thing, trying to figure out what setting to go for. Or maybe you took an espresso class and they told you to take a whole lot of beans and grind them up super fine. Finally, that advice makes sense since there's a lot of surface area for the water to pull all those yummy coffee compounds from. But pulverizing your coffee into literal dust might not be the way to go, at least according to mathematics. The Darcy-Forkheimer law, named after the engineers that developed it, was originally designed to explain how water flows through a column of sand. But it works just as well for coffee. It predicts how water is going to flow over those coffee grounds, depending on things like the gradient the water's moving along and the area the water's moving through. And that can tell you something about how strong or flavorful the brew might be. If the particles are too fine, the water can't get through, and that coffee spends ages having the juice sucked out of it, making it bitter or over-extracted. Too coarse, though, and the hot water just flows right over the grounds, under-extracting the flavors, and leaving you with a sour coffee. In a study from 2020, researchers created and tested a mathematical model based partly on the Darcy-Forkheimer law to dial in the perfect espresso setup. When they ground the beans too fine, they ended up with uneven regions of pressure building up on that little mound of coffee. That meant only some of the coffee was properly extracted, and they ended up with coffees that were different from one cup to the next. So unlike the typical barista lore, they found that using less coffee, 15 grams instead of the usual 20, and grinding it more coarsely consistently gave them much better tasting brews. And just like science in general, reproducibility is what you want when it comes to your morning cup. Plus, by using less beans, you end up with more cups of coffee from your bag and less waste. Win-win. Now, we all know that one curmudgeonly person who insists on ordering their latte extra hot. Or the one purist who says iced coffee is an abomination to the coffee art form. Although neither is really 100% right, temperature does play a pretty big role in how that final cup tastes. The National Coffee Association recommends a temperature of between 90 and 96 degrees Celsius or 195 and 205 Fahrenheit, just under boiling temperature. That's because the temperature of the water dictates how fast all those flavor compounds seep out of the grind. See, as temperature increases, the water molecules gain energy and interact more with the coffee grounds. More interaction means more extraction. Now, some coffee flavor compounds that are really soluble in water get sucked out of the coffee quickly, regardless of temperature. These include the quinic, malic, and citric acids. But there are also compounds that dissolve differently in water at different temperatures. These are mostly the compounds that give coffee its bitter taste, like the alkaloids we talked about earlier. So with hotter water, you get more of these bitter compounds leaching out. Extra hot water can also let out other compounds like pyrazines, which give an earthy or burnt taste. Which is probably why people often report that coffee brewed at hotter temperatures can taste pretty bitter. But scalded coffee is also described as sour, which doesn't immediately make sense since the sour compounds come out regardless of temperature. Coffee scientists, who basically have my dream job, think that bitter and sour compounds have an additive effect. So if more bitter compounds like caffeine get into the water at hotter temps, then this makes the sour compounds taste more sour. Now, you might be wondering about cold brew. In cold brewing, it's time doing all the work, not temperature. The cool water slowly sucks those flavor compounds out of the grounds. And some compounds, including the chlorogenic acids and trigonelline, leach out much more slowly. So depending on how long you steep the coffee for, cold brew is generally sweeter and less acidic. And now that you've got your brewer, your beans, and a whole bunch of science knowledge, you're ready to go and make your coffee. All this said, the perfect cup of coffee is the one you like the best. If you're looking to improve your brewing game, feel free to bring what you've learned here into the kitchen. But if your coffee hits the spot, there's no science that can tell you you're wrong. And this one is pretty darn good. I'm gonna grab a refill. But first, I need to thank Brilliant for supporting this list show. Brilliant is an online learning platform with thousands of interactive lessons in math, science, and computer science. Like their course in measurement that covers angles, length, area, surface area, and volume. And that last one might come in handy when you're trying to figure out how much coffee you can fit in your favorite mug. Brilliant courses are even available offline using their iOS and Android app. So if you're at one of those cafes that doesn't share Wi-Fi, you'll still be able to keep learning. You can check it out at brilliant.org/scishow or in the link in the description down below. That link also gives you a free 30-day trial and 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription. Thanks for watching this SciShow video.